Extinguish your fires.
Then God said, let there be lights in the dome of
reading from the book of Genesis. God put Abraham to the test. He called to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son Isaac, your only one, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah. There you shall offer him up as a holocaust on a height that I will point out to you." Early the next morning, Abraham saddled his donkey, took with him his son Isaac, and two of his servants as well. And with the wood he had cut for the holocaust, set out for the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham got sight of the place from afar. Then he said to his servants, "Both of you stay here with the donkey, while the boy and I go on over yonder. We will worship and then come back to you." Thereupon, Abraham took the wood for the holocaust and laid it on his son Isaac's shoulders, while he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two walked on together, Isaac spoke to his father Abraham. "Father," Isaac said. "Yes, son," he replied. Isaac continued, "Here are the fire and the wood, but where is the sheep for the holocaust?" "Son," Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the sheep for the holocaust." Then the two continued going forward. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. Next, he tied up his son Isaac and put him on top of the wood on the altar. Then he reached out and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the Lord's messenger called to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he answered. "Do not lay your hand on the boy," said the messenger. "Do not do the least thing to him. I know now how devoted you are to God, since you did not withhold from me your own beloved son." As Abraham looked about, he spied a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. So he went and took the ram and offered it up as a holocaust in place of his son. Abraham named the site Yahweh Yireh. Hence, people now say, "On the mountain the Lord will see." Again, the Lord's messenger called to Abraham from heaven and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you acted as you did in not withholding from me your beloved son, I will bless you abundantly and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. All this because you obeyed my command." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. A reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses, "Why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward, and you lift up your staff, and with hand outstretched over the sea, split the sea in two, that the Israelites may pass through it on dry land. But I will make the Egyptians so obstinate that they will go in after them. Then I will receive glory for Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and charioteers. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord. When I receive glory from Pharaoh and his chariots and charioteers, the angel of God who had been leading Israel's camp now moved and went around behind them. The column of cloud also, leaving the front, took up its place behind them, so that it came between the camp of the Egyptians and that of Israel. But the cloud now became dark, and thus the night passed without the rival camps coming any closer together all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea with a strong east wind throughout the night, and so turned it into dry land. When the water was thus divided, the Israelites marched into the midst of the sea on dry land, with the water like a wall, to their right and to their left. The Egyptians followed in pursuit. All Pharaoh's horses and chariots and charioteers went after them, right into the midst of the sea. In the night watch, just before dawn, the Lord passed through the column of the fiery cloud upon the Egyptian force a glance that threw it into panic. And so he clogged their chariot wheels that they could hardly drive. With that, the Egyptians sounded the retreat before Israel, because the Lord was fighting for them against the Egyptians. Then the Lord told Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may flow back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and their charioteers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn, the sea flowed back to its normal depth. The Egyptians were fleeing head-on toward the sea when the Lord hurled them into its midst. As the water flowed back, it covered the chariots and the charioteers of Pharaoh's whole army, which had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not a single one of them escaped. But the Israelites had marched on dry land through the midst of the sea, with water like a wall to their right and to their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel on that day from the power of the Egyptians. When Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the seashore and beheld the great power that the Lord had shown against the Egyptians, they feared the Lord and believed in him and his servant Moses. Then Moses and the Israelites sang this song to the Lord. "I will sing to the Lord, for he is gloriously triumphant. Horse and chariot he has cast into the sea." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The one who has become your husband is your maker. His name is the Lord of hosts. Your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel, called God of all the earth. The Lord calls you back, like a wife forsaken and grieved in spirit, a wife married in youth and then cast off, says your God. For a brief moment, I abandoned you, but with great tenderness, I will take you back. In an outburst of wrath, for a moment, I hid my face from you, but with enduring love, I take pity on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. This is for me like the days of Noah, when I swore that the waters of Noah should never again deluge the earth. So I have sworn not to be angry with you or to rebuke you. Though the mountains leave their place and the hills be shaken, my love shall never leave you, nor my covenant of peace be shaken, says the Lord, who has mercy on you. O afflicted one, storm-battered and unconsoled, I lay your pavements in carnelians and your foundations in sapphires. I will make your battlements of rubies, your gates of carbuncles, and all your walls of precious stone. All your children shall be taught by the Lord, and great shall be the peace of your children. In justice shall you be established, far from the fear of oppression, where destruction cannot come near you. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. and through sacred adoption increase the children of your promise, so that what the saints of old never doubted will have come to pass, your church shall see in great part fulfilled, through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.
Defiled with the dead, accounted with those destined for the netherworld.
Such is our God. No other is to be compared to him. He has traced out the whole way of understanding and has given her to Jacob, his servant, to Israel, his beloved son. Since then, she has appeared on earth and moved among people. She is the book of the precepts of God, the law that endures forever. All who cling to her will live, but those will die who forsake her. Turn, O Jacob, and receive her. Walk by her light toward splendor. Give not your glory to another, your privileges to an alien race. Blessed are we, O Israel, for what pleases God is known to us. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
perfectly accomplish the work of human salvation, which you plan from all eternity. May the whole world know and see that what was cast out is raised up, what had become old is made new, and all things are restored to integrity through Christ, justified in thinking and to be, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Buried with him through baptism into death,
At daybreak, on the first day of the week, the women who had come from Galilee with Jesus took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were puzzling over this, behold, two men in dazzling garments appeared to them. They were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. They said to them, "Why do you seek the living one among the dead? He is not here, but he has been raised. Remember what he said to you while he was still in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be handed over to sinners and be crucified and rise on the third day." And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and announced all these things to the 11 and to all the others. The women were Mary Magdalene, Joanna, and Mary, the mother of James. The others who accompanied them also told this to the apostles. But their story seemed like nonsense, and they did not believe them. But Peter got up and ran to the tomb, bent down, and saw the burial cloth alone. Then he went home, amazed at what had happened. The Gospel of the Lord.
world, including ours. And he cleansed it with his blood, with his mercy, and the love of the Father. And then he took it all into the tomb with him. You know, for you and me, the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the central event, not only of all time in history, but of our lives, and it draws all the other events into itself. And for our sake, the Father has given away, his most precious possession, his Son. And the Son was willing to let himself be given away. As we listen to the proclamations of sacred scripture, we heard again and again and again how the heart of God was displayed as we walked through salvation history. Those seven passages from the Old Testament represented key epic moments in the long history of God's dealing with the people of Israel. And the Christian community has always used them to understand Christ's death and resurrection as the fulfillment of all the works and promises of God, beginning back in that time. From a liturgical sense, I don't know if you've heard it in these readings, but they lead us to baptism and the Eucharist. The primary focus of this night, baptism and Eucharist, the primary focus of this night. Because these two sacraments are our primary means of communion in Christ's death and resurrection. It's the way that we are united and brought into union with Jesus in his suffering and death and resurrection. You know, tonight we first heard how this love story between God and humanity began in the story of creation. This man and woman were created in God's image and in his likeness. But the whole of creation, all of it, not only back then, but even now, the whole of creation culminates in Christ's paschal sacrifice. Our new creation is in Jesus Christ. And then we heard the story of how the Hebrew people were saved from the bondage of Pharaoh through the waters of the Red Sea. An image of the way God has freed you and me from sin and death through baptism. And the story of Abraham and Isaac as he prepares to sacrifice his own son. It's a mysterious foreshadowing of the sacrifice of God the Father, who so loved the world that he gave his only son. Both Isaac and Jesus are innocent victims, but they both carry the wood on which they will be offered. See the connection? And ultimately both are spared by the hand of God. And the prophets, Isaiah, Baruch, and Ezekiel, they proclaim God's forgiveness, and they invite us into conversion and to the waters of baptism, as well as an invitation to the Eucharist, in which the sacrament of baptism finds its culmination, in which resurrection is shared with us in this magnificent banquet. The Lord desires to give you and me, all of us, a new heart and a new spirit, extending to each of us an invitation to enter into that intimate relationship with God. The covenant is renewed once again. What did we hear from Ezekiel? You shall be my people, and I will be your God. That's a renewal of this covenant that God desires for each one of us. Those words weren't just for 2,000 or 2,500 years ago. They're for today. But friends, this history of old is our history. just invite you, after you leave here tonight, go back home and ponder on these readings. Because it is the history of all of us, and how God has intervened into our lives. Personally, and intimately, to lead us into our own salvation history. And for those of you coming into the church tonight, this is a very important part. Tonight is a very important part of your salvation history. It's not just something you're going through. This is a moment in your salvation. And it's not to be taken lightly or for granted, I know that's not what you're doing, but it's something in which we all should be amazed. This is a life-changing moment for you. And as they go through this life-changing moment, it's a time for us to reflect back upon that time when we were going through what they were going through. Because it will, again, tonight, can be a life-changing moment. All of us, if we do that. Never forget the ways, the moments, the interventions in which God broke into your lives, leading you to this important moment in your salvation history and all of your salvation history. Again, be amazed at God's astonishing mercy and his generous concern for you. This love is at the end. This love of the heart of the Father. It's truly amazing. And we began the celebration tonight out there in darkness, standing in darkness, no? And then carrying this beautiful paschal candle lit from the Easter fire into the darkness of this cathedral. All these symbols mean a lot. I don't have time to explain them all. We'd be here until 3 tomorrow morning. But we would be amazed. But this symbol is the one crucified and risen. Christ is this pillar of fire in the cloud, and it is now we who are led out of the Egypt of sin and death into the light of this church. The heart of Jesus, like a candle, was made visible as he was consumed by love. As he gave himself so totally and so completely. This love, his love, has profoundly reshaped the world, has profoundly transformed creation, reducing evil and sin to rubble, for us who believe, and allowing us to be absorbed by this love. Catechumens, in baptism, this light will be given to you to be kept burning brighter. In baptism, this light has been given to all of us to be taken out into the world. This paschal candle, this light of Christ, will remain here in this church and kept lit for the next 7 weeks until Pentecost, when there will be a new outpouring of the Holy Spirit. But keeping us ever mindful that Jesus Christ is the light of the world, and he has been consumed for our sake. So my dear friends, this too is our call, to go out and be consumed for his sake. If we have died with Christ, we must see ourselves as being consumed for him. And you know, we will never become or be empty-handed when giving our lives away. Why? Why? Because the resurrection of Jesus Christ has brought about an eternal spring of grace.
greater challenge to all of us. It truly is. In fact, I don't think there's a greater challenge today as our culture tries to remove Jesus from it altogether. But the good news is there are many examples for us in the lives of the saints. We can learn it and follow and ask to intercede for us. Through the gift of the Holy Spirit tonight, you will be given all that you will ever need and letting yourself be consumed for Christ. And the Holy Eucharist, the gift of Christ himself, his body and blood, is our nourishment in accepting Christ's mission to take the gospel to the ends of the earth. In the Holy Eucharist, Jesus is suffering and death on the cross is once again, will once again be made present on this very altar. His sacrificial blood will be made present right here on this altar. The outpouring of his love and mercy becomes real again. And then in this encounter, he gives himself to us in totality. In totality, nothing held back. He can't give anymore. So that you and I might be transformed into him and become this living presence, his living presence in this world. My dear friends, yes, Christ has loved us to the end. He's a love without us. The love which got him mocked and trampled and humiliated and crucified. But it's a love that could not be held in a cold, dark tomb. The raising of his son was God's final and definitive answer. His final and definitive answer to every imaginable fear, every possible pain, every suffering of any kind that any human being could ever have, including the fear of pain and death. The resurrection of Jesus Christ was God's greatest accomplishment. And so, my dear friends, tonight, you and I are truly blessed. We rejoice tonight that Christ chose